The following is a Project 8 Family First special presentation. An innocent bike ride.
I just was screaming her name, but there was never no answer. There was nothing.
A sudden nightmare.
Please bring her home for me.
The murder of a little girl.
We feel that this tentatively is going to be the body of Amber Hagerman.
From anguish to action.
So as a mother, I am asking you to change the laws, protect all the children.
A journey through grief.
There's no way that my daughter's death is going to be in vain.
Tonight, After Amber. Now your host, Pam Curry.
It was the unthinkable. A little girl kidnapped, kicking and screaming in broad daylight from an Arlington parking lot. Her name was Amber Hagerman, and we knew her. We'd spent weeks with Amber and her family videotaping them for a special about welfare reform. So when she disappeared, her family invited us to be with them through their agonizing wait. During the next hour, you'll meet Amber as we did, and share her family's private journey through grief and healing. We begin with their very personal memories of those first five terrible days.
As soon as we got to my parents' home, they rushed out of the car, they get their bicycles off the porch, they went go around the block. My son comes back, you know, by himself.
I'd seen that little girl over there playing up and down there.
Arlington 911, what are you reporting?
Yeah, I saw a black pickup, and he grabbed the little girl and he took off toward town with her. Uh-huh. And she hollered. And
so my father, he left to go find her.
And while I was talking to the policeman, her granddad drove up.
So then I went back and told Donna that somebody had got Amber.
Of course, my dad had his serious face on. I knew he was not messing with me. I knew he was telling me the truth. I just went crazy then. I just started going towards where my father said she was abducted at, screaming her name, thought maybe for sure she would answer me. But there was never no answer. There was nothing. We had flyers out, and just within hours of Amber, we were sticking them everywhere. I just stood outside, just constantly waiting and waiting and waiting. The police told me I had to go inside because all the media and everybody's starting to come.
Yeah, I thought maybe we had the news media there that, you know, that they get Amber's picture out and get information out that somebody maybe, you know, would call in or something.
One day was this quiet neighborhood, and the next day the whole world seemed like it was just rushing in.
I wanted to be in the limelight and wanted people to know, you know, my daughter's out there somewhere.
There were so many strangers that come through the house, and we even wondered if maybe the one that got Amber could have even walked in the house and we wouldn't have known it.
And it doesn't sound like someone that the little girl knew or someone that she was going with voluntarily.
I remember the emotion. I don't really like to remember it because I didn't believe it.
We want her back.
I'd go back and look at tapes that I would plead to the doctor, you know.
Thank you. Don't hurt my little girl.
Some of the things like that I just don't remember doing.
The search in the immediate area does go on, although police say the reality is if this alleged kidnapper was in that pickup truck, he could have driven off and be long gone by now.
Give them the strength.
The whole family, we were just going crazy those few days. We were just hoping and wishing so hard and praying so hard that she would come back. And nothing. Just kept on hearing nothing, you know. I was telling the police, you know, you got to find my little girl and you got to do it now because it's been so long, you know. You need to find my little girl now. I want her home now.
Was it a Chevy, Ford, or?
Can you describe this guy to me that you saw?
What kind of truck is it?
We had so many strangers and volunteers just coming up from the woodworks just wanting to help. Amber was missing and everybody wanted to get involved. Everybody wanted to do something.
This will make her happy to see this on TV.
Awards that she's received.
It's a scrapbook I'd seen before, Amber's prized possession.
You're doing these stamps and you have to do the perfect.
On a November evening in 1995, she beamed with pride as she showed me the honors she'd earned.
I had to get A honor roll, A, B honor roll, and I had to do good things in the class and help.
So you make good grades?
Mm-hmm.
Amber's shy smile spoke volumes about how much school meant to her.
She loves school. She's AB honor roll, perfect attendance.
How many students?
Amber's passion for education was instilled early in her life by her mother, who'd learned the hard way how valuable school could be. Donna dropped out after seventh grade. And when we first met in the fall of 1995, she and her two children were living on welfare. The year before, Donna left Richard Hagerman, moving from what she says was an abusive relationship into a women's shelter. By her own choice, she received no child support. On her own, for the first time in her life, Donna now understood the value of education.
Going to school is my only option, my only ticket out of my situation I'm in, so I get a better training for a better job, so I can support myself and my two children.
During the early months, we witnessed her determination. She'd earned a high school equivalency degree, was on a waiting list for job training, and volunteering at the Arlington Welfare Office.
So your instructor or whomever is going to be...
Case manager Penny Livingston saw Donna's confidence growing.
I'm sure she's going to succeed because she hasn't let anything stand in her way yet.
For Donna, Amber, and Ricky, life on welfare was a struggle. They wore clothes from local charities.
Today I was looking for sweaters, sweatshirts, long pants, long shirts for my kids so they stay warm this winter.
But at important times, Donna sacrificed and splurged. 3 weeks before Amber's birthday, she made the final payment on a present, a t-shirt, leggings, socks, doll accessories, and Pocahontas sheets.
This here came to $40, which ain't much, but it's all I could afford for.
The family worked as a team. Donna's goal was to raise her children in a quiet, calm home.
God is good.
To help them prepare for the future.
Amen.
It was clear mother and daughter share a special bond.
Look, Mom, I made this for you.
Thank you. That's pretty. Dear Mom, this is for you that I made at school. I love you a lot. Love, Amber.
Right away, you sense the love between Donna and Amber, a little girl, mature, smart, and intuitive, whom her mother called a worrywart.
No, that's what makes it tougher. I have a 9-year-old child worrying about... You know, we're going to have money tomorrow.
But there were no worries at Amber's 9th birthday party.
I can wish you blow my baby. All right.
She and her friends celebrated.
Happy birthday, darling.
Ooh.
Love you.
Whoa, this is heavy.
Found for mommy.
The gifts from her mother, especially the Pocahontas sheets, brought a priceless reaction.
Turn it around and see what it is.
Living on welfare was a constant balancing act for the family. The obstacles seemed frequent, but somehow manageable.
I can't do it.
Until one November day, a huge crisis. Donna's 23-year-old car broke down. She desperately needed the car to get to job training classes in Fort Worth.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
The car got repaired. Mission Arlington helped, and Donna arrived early for the first day of class. She overcame the crisis.
I was desperate to come here today, and I wanted to be here today, and nothing's going to get in my way.
This is Angie, your instructor.
Hi, Angie. Nice to meet you.
Welcome to her class.
Donna felt she was on the verge of achieving her dreams.
Take one makeup tip.
An education, a good job, freedom from welfare, and one day, a house in the country with Ricky and Amber. Donna was confident she could change life's direction, especially for the two little ones who were her inspiration.
Have you ever felt like just giving up?
Oh yeah, several times. But then when I get to that point, I look at my beautiful children and I say, no, I can't give up.
Together, Donna, Amber, and Ricky overcame every obstacle and crisis thrown in their way. It was a bright moment. Donna's dreams were within reach, but nothing could have prepared her or any of us for the nightmare, the darkness she suddenly faced.
We interrupt this program to bring you the following News 8 special report.
We have late developments into the Channel 8 newsroom, and it is a rather ominous development in the case of 9-year-old Amber Hagerman.
Apparently he was walking our dog, and he had looked over the fence and had saw something white, looked again and noticed that it was a body.
I immediately knew something was wrong, and they started getting the yellow tape out, put it around my mom's home. I just went crazy then. I said, no, you're not going to tell me something that I don't want to hear.
The chaplain arrived here about 1 in the morning and did speak with the family for some time.
He said, we don't know if it's Amber or not. We don't know.
I work with the investigators. The investigators work with me. We try to make sure that we're getting good information to the victims.
And we just, you know, sit around, we waited, we listened to the news. We just kept hoping and praying that it wasn't Amber.
You know, everybody knew something and nobody knew nothing.
You know, as people comes up saying, oh, I know how you feel right there. That's what I used to think too, but you don't know how you'd feel unless it happens to you.
Nothing on the record, nothing official yet.
I know they were dying for information and there wasn't anything that I could give to them until we got the final word.
That wait was the worst wait I ever had in my life.
Now tonight, police believe, are not confirming, but witnesses say,
you know, we waited hours and hours, and that was so hard. But I know in a little way I knew that it was Amber.
It came out of a creek bed that lies a little bit down low.
And when they finally told me it was her, of course I didn't believe it. When she was abducted, I thought, oh God, you know, I'm never going to be able to touch her again, hold her again, you know, talk to her ever again. And I wanted to see her before the autopsy, before they even touched her. They didn't want me to see her the way she was because she was damaged so much. Her body was cut so much and she just didn't look like Amber.
Amber Hagerman's funeral will take place tomorrow afternoon at 2:00 at the First United Methodist Church in Arlington.
And that was hard too, to let her go again. Oh God, I've just found her. I finally got to touch her and hold her and talk to her. And I just told her that Mommy found you and I miss you. That made me feel real good.
May God grant us peace, that in our sorrow we may know hope.
It's like she was taken away from me again.
Our little Amber's a little angel in heaven now. We're gonna miss her.
Look at everything in here.
The intense coverage of Amber's kidnapping and murder brings a flood of condolences. Donna wades through the tangible evidence of a nation's sympathy.
We are praying for all of you.
2 days after Amber's funeral, Donna delivers hundreds of the stuffed animals she's received to the women's shelter, which had helped her, Ricky, and Amber.
She knew that Amber would want other kids to be able to have these animals and to love them.
Donna's private grieving continues at her parents' house, the last place she saw Amber alive. She's not ready to go back to her apartment yet. Ricky avoids much of the activity around him by blocking it out. He's confused by it all.
No, I know I picked him up one day from school and he goes, Mama, is Amber home sleeping, you know? Of course, I had to remind him that she's in heaven and he goes, oh, I forgot Mama.
The media's still outside, but no longer around the clock.
And again, I'd like to thank everybody, and God bless everybody for all their help.
Donna finds herself working with Richard Hagerman for their daughter's sake. Her new role as a public figure begins to take shape.
Something needs to be changed, and it needs to be now.
Amber's death sparks reaction at an Arlington City Council meeting.
I'm terrified to let my children outside.
Neighbors vent their fears there.
You know, we're all outraged now, but what are we going to do to protect our children?
And at Amber's school the same night.
We're frightened. We're really scared.
This is tearing me apart because it's hard.
The community's grief overflows at the abduction site and at Amber's grave. A steady stream of visitors comes. Some knew her, most didn't. Drawn for various reasons, all coping with a sense of private loss in this very public tragedy.
Come on, you ready to go? Let's go.
Donna, too, learns to cope with life as it is now, doing something that frightens this 28-year-old mother. She's agreed to fly to New York for a television appearance. Donna's first flight, her first trip to the Big Apple.
Come here, Mama's gonna leave. Come here.
And her first time to leave her 5-year-old son.
Mama's gonna miss you. Give me a kiss.
Love you. But Donna feels she has to do all she can to help find Amber's killer.
What do you want the laws to say?
We want
first-time offenders, life in prison without parole.
It's a pleasure to meet you. I have admired your tenacity and all that you've been doing.
Once back home, the hectic pace continues, a town meeting appearance.
The one strike. Because this person is a sick person.
With an outraged audience.
I'm here speaking for dead children.
And someone who truly understands.
It's extremely painful. My goodness.
Mark Class's daughter, Polly, was also kidnapped and murdered.
There's never a full closure on any of this, but it's all chapters in the book.
For Donna, the next chapter opens the next day. It's February 4th, 2 weeks since Amber died. Donna suddenly decides today's the day to leave her parents' house. It is a turning point. For the first time, Donna's going home without Amber.
Let's see it, yeah.
The pain is excruciating. As she enters the apartment, everything looks the same, but now feels so different.
Who put this in Amber's room?
Time, it seems, has stood still. We all almost expect Amber to be here, but the rooms are only filled with memories. Amber's backpack is beside the front door where she tossed it, her newest brownie badges in a bag on top. A puzzle remains unfinished on the kitchen table. But Amber's bedding, her Pocahontas sheets, are gone, taken by police for the investigation.
Her dolls.
Donna, her mother, and sister are overcome.
I keep everything in her. In this whole house, there's nothing but her. That's what's going to be hard.
Amber's no longer here, yet she's everywhere. The pictures, the sweatshirt she wore just before she was taken.
It's filthy as could be because she wore it Thursday, but I don't think I want to wash it. It's got her on it, so.
They feel close to Amber here. It all feels so normal and makes her death even harder to grasp. Ricky, however, just seems relieved to be home.
Great job in multiplications. Amber's ahead. It's hard to look at it and touch it. I just wish she was here. I miss her so much. My kids are my world. Amber's gone. Now half my world's gone. It's so hard.
Now, Donna truly begins a journey, finding a way to live without Amber, the daughter she called her best friend. But it is a journey she won't make alone. Jimmy Whitson is a quiet man with a grim task, picking up his granddaughter's belongings taken for the investigation.
We got no new lead or nothing.
Well, actually, they're working on several things, but we don't have them confirmed yet.
Daryl and Perryman had delivered news of Amber's death. Now the crime victims coordinator is there for them again.
This is Mr. Whitson. He's here to pick up Amber Hagerman's stuff.
It's all there, Amber's bicycle, a treasured teddy bear, and the Pocahontas sheets.
Well, it's difficult, but you know, it's something that's got to do. Because Donna wants Amber's stuff back.
They're only things, but they mean so much more when they belong to someone that you've lost.
As Jimmy reclaims Amber's things, he tries to hold his emotions in check. It's something a grandfather, no one, he says, should have to do. And Perriman realizes there's little she can say to make this easier.
I know I can't fix them, I can't solve this, I can't make this up to anybody. But if I can give them some information that's helpful to them, if I can be there to listen when they need me to, then I've done something.
But police can't give family members what they really need, a suspect.
Police today released new information they hope will provide a psychological profile of the person who killed the Arlington 9-year-old.
The police investigation is moving ahead. They release the killer's profile and say something the family doesn't want to hear.
We believe that the suspect kept Amber Hagerman alive for up to 48 hours after she was abducted.
That reality hits Donna hard. The possibility that Amber might have been tortured and perhaps could have been saved. In private and in public.
Nearest thing to heaven is a child.
The goodbyes seem constant. A Valentine's Day vigil draws friends, neighbors, and strangers to the place Amber was last seen.
Thank God for kids.
A sea of candles light the night, letting Amber's family know they're not alone.
And I'll always remember those faces. I just thank God for these people that came out here tonight.
The memories of Amber are overwhelming.
You think it gets better each day goes by. It don't. To me, it's worse.
Write your congressmen, write your senators.
Amber's father, Richard, focuses on changing the law.
Write everybody, tell them this is election year. Write them and tell them what you want done.
The family is understandably angry. So are many in the community. But without an arrest, there's no one person to focus that anger on. So their attention turns to strengthening laws against sex offenders.
Fight forever.
Petitions quickly circulate, demanding harsher sentences. A grassroots group of volunteers ask for signatures and donations to keep the petition drive going. They raise funds at a bake sale to buy office supplies, but the well-intentioned efforts soon become disjointed and disorganized.
I called it my jump on my horse and go off in all directions at one time stage.
Patsy Day tries to help.
The lawmakers would not even talk to us about longer prison terms.
Sharing her expertise about what it takes to change the law. She knows. Her daughter Jennifer was also kidnapped and murdered. She spent a decade helping crime victims.
You have to learn a whole new vocabulary. You have to learn new skills. You have to learn how the system works to start with before you know what needs to be fixed.
Amber Hagerman, petitioner, Rob Bruce speaking. May I help you?
It's not long before the group of volunteers becomes much smaller. They choose a name, People Against Sex Offenders, or PASO. A church provides office space.
You know why we have this kind of revolving door policy in Texas.
Richard now devotes full time to directing the group's efforts.
It's changed my life.
He isn't ready to go back to his job yet.
Yeah, this is registered sex offenders right here on this wall. It's therapy for me. I think it does me good to get involved in this because it was my daughter and you know, I couldn't be there to help her, but this is the only way I can help her. This is where we do all the counting.
By March, they've collected thousands of signatures from around Texas, but plans for a protest march in Austin are now on hold. On hold, too, is the family's ability to move on. There are thousands of leads, but no arrest, no suspect. On a Saturday afternoon, Donna takes her parents, sister, and a friend to the creek where Amber was found. There they meet Stuart Coker, the man who discovered her body. He's haunted at being thrust into their tragedy. He had been walking his dog when he made the gruesome discovery.
I saw Amber's body lying in the water. And I knew what it was right away.
And so you can see it just kind of weaves around like this.
Now, weeks later, Coker is still consumed by the tragedy.
For me, I can't get the vision out of my mind. I can't believe that somebody did something like this. I mean, I come down here and I stand and I cry.
He and his family return again and again to the creek behind their apartment. They walk the banks and rake the creek bottom, a desperate attempt to find evidence and answers.
It was a tragic thing, and unfortunately, there's no explanation for any of it.
Stuart Coker never met Amber Hagerman. But somehow he feels he knows her.
She was such a lively young lady, and she certainly was cute. There's no doubt about that. She's a pretty little girl.
It was so fun just to watch her grow and teach her things.
Amber was the little girl Donna always dreamed of having. Donna was 19, Richard 36, when Amber was born. They were happy when they brought their newborn home on Thanksgiving Day 1986, but they never legally married. Donna felt her baby girl was a miracle of sorts. As a young teenager, Donna battled a rare illness, which temporarily paralyzed her from the waist down.
They told me I never would walk again. They told me I'd never have kids. I proved them wrong.
Donna's first baby, Glenda's first grandchild, Amber quickly became the center of attention.
She was always full of life, kept us going.
Glenda told me about their special, simple times, eating vanilla ice cream, reading, and singing together.
She loved to have her picture made. She's always posing for pictures.
4 years later, those pictures included little brother Ricky.
She always called him Bubba. He'd always call her Sissy. You know, it was always Sissy and Bubba.
Amber and Ricky were close. They spent hours playing together outdoors, just like they did the day she disappeared.
She loved to ride her bicycle. She loved her Barbie doll. She just loved life. That's all the things that this guy stole from us. He stole all this from us.
When Amber died, the killer stole a little something from all of us. From Amanda, he took a best friend.
That night that they showed it on the news, I got real scared and I go, why is Amber's picture up there?
Amanda and Amber were inseparable, more like sisters than friends, together at parties, in school, and in brownies. Amanda's mom, Linda, was their troop leader.
She had so much ahead of her in life. I could see it in her. She was just one that, you know, set her goals and achieved them.
Linda considered the sometimes shy but fun-loving Amber like another daughter. That's why the loss and the guilt feel so big.
It's kind of an emptiness. You just go through those things of, you know, what if I'd have just had her at my house that day?
Amber's third grade teacher feels it too. She misses the creative and considerate little girl.
She was a perfectionist. She tried at everything she did. If she didn't do as well on an assignment as she wanted to, she redid it. She loved creative writing. That was her specialty, and she was really, really good at it.
And there's Amber.
Amber was good, too, her friend Cassie remembers, to just about everyone.
She was nice, funny. She wasn't mean to anybody.
That's one reason Amber's disappearance and death seemed so confusing.
Yeah, it wasn't her fault. She didn't do anything to anybody.
Cassie shows me the memories of her friend.
Okay, this is a bench that Mr. Whitson made.
A bench Amber's grandfather built. A teddy bear named Amber. And she tells me about a special note.
I wrote, "Amber, I miss you a lot. I wish you were still here because it's not the same without you here."
It's how many feel, sad, confused, and increasingly anxious to turn those emotions into action. It's a windy, warm February afternoon, 1 month since Amber's death.
It's our most important guests, the Whitson family and the Hagerman family.
The grieving community gathers at Amber's school, Berry Elementary in Arlington, for a special occasion.
Today we dedicate this playground area in honor of our fellow student, Amber Hagerman.
The mood is mostly upbeat, the face is happy. Yet for the children, an unspoken question lingers. Why did Amber have to die? Amber's classmates, the third graders, expressed through music what many can't say in words.
Keep smiling, keep shining, though you can't always count on me.
They miss her, so do the teachers.
Reality hit, and I knew she wasn't coming back. That was definitely the hardest part for me.
With the help of art therapy and writing, they're getting better.
That's what friends are for.
It's not as easy for Amber's family. The chorus of young voices touches each in a different way.
His words are coming from my heart.
You may cut the ribbon on our new playground equipment.
Then, the ribbon cut, the ceremony over. Amber's playground welcomes her friends and her little brother Ricky. Each moment, each event, each step moves them further from Amber's death, but not further from her memory.
Wait, Ricky.
For Donna, this is a day for another agonizing first. The visit, she tells us, she has to make to Amber's classroom.
Hi, guys.
Right away, she sees Amber's empty desk. And in the back of the room, there's an Amber Museum, a memorial made by the third graders.
It was all done in pink and hearts and things that she liked, and just anything they could think of that made them feel good about Amber, we put back there.
Then come the questions, painful and familiar.
What time did she leave on her bike?
At 3:10 Saturday afternoon, and she was abducted at 3:18. Just took 8 minutes. It only takes seconds. So you gotta stay close to home, okay?
Did they leave Amber's bike there?
Amber's grandfather went and picked her bike up.
She's gentle with the children, concerned about how they feel.
Was there any fingerprints?
Any fingerprints? No. The bad man took Amber right off her bicycle. He didn't touch Amber's bicycle. He just grabbed Amber. There were no fingerprints of any kind.
Then, without prompting, the children try to make Donna feel better.
I liked her a lot.
Thank you.
She's really pretty.
Thank you.
I always wanted to play with her.
Thank you.
She was nice.
Their tenderness touches Amber's teacher.
She touched a lot of hearts. It's a little hard to hold back the tears, especially right now. But
I know, I don't know how you do that.
I don't either. I don't either.
But the journey of grief is in many ways unpredictable. At a special Girl Scout ceremony, America the Beautiful, Amber's favorite song, brings Donna to tears. It's now almost 2 months since her little girl's death. This was one of Amber's dreams, to become a junior Girl Scout. But this night, Amanda and other friends move up from Brownies without her. Donna wants to be here, but Ricky can't seem to sit still, ignoring his family, acting up during the ceremony, behavior he's shown since his sister died. Despite that, Donna takes Amber's place in the ceremony, finishing what her daughter started.
It's special for me, and Amber, she waited for this moment for a long time. Thank you.
As she accepts her little girl's awards, Donna imagines seeing her here. It's hard, she tells me, to watch Amber's friends growing up, going on.
Is no longer here with us in person, but she is with us in spirit.
10 days later, the girls in Amber's troop gather to say their own goodbyes. It's something they want to do. They talk, pray, and sing. Then, pink balloons carry loving notes to Amber in heaven. Her whole family is here. Donna feels stronger being with the children. She wants to hear what they have to say.
It's real hard on me, but it's special too. It comes from the heart.
The girls leave a friendship chain and flowers. There's no permanent marker yet, but weeks later, that changes. Amber's headstone arrives, cold, hard proof that the bright-eyed child isn't coming back. Accepting Amber's death will never be easy, especially if the killer's never caught.
Why did you hurt her? Why did you terrify her?
She wants answers, and she's ready to take action. The cruel winter in which Amber Hagerman died now gives way to spring. On this warm, sunny day, Jimmy Whitson works diligently on a project for his daughter, Donna. He once spent hours making things for his grandchildren, but he stopped when Amber died. Now he makes an exception, creating a cross in his granddaughter's memory.
You had it in your mind that you was making this for Amber?
On Mother's Day, the family plants Amber's cross near an Arlington freeway, a few blocks from the place her body was found. It's important to them, the marker to remind passersby of Amber, and somehow maybe lead to a break in the case.
What's the license plate number on the ticket?
By 2.5 months into the murder investigation, Arlington police have received more than 3,000 leads. None has turned up the killer.
We have every reason to believe that this individual may have committed this crime before.
A 15-member task force headed by Sergeant Mark Simpson tries a new approach, inviting authorities from around the state to discuss the abduction and murder. After a 3-month investigation and no results, Donna is exhausted and angry.
I'm frustrated. I'm losing hope.
So she decides to take action by writing to the killer.
You did a very horrible act. I hope to hell you're satisfied. My little girl did nothing to you. Why did you hurt her? Why did you terrify her?
A one-page handwritten letter demanding to know what happened, hoping the killer will write back after seeing the letter in the media.
I just can't sit at home and do nothing. I have to do something.
And Donna feels the need to take action in other areas of her life, too.
My main concern is my son.
She takes Ricky to the Warm Place in Fort Worth, a grief support group for children and their families. Ricky's shy and a little scared.
Does it feel pretty safe under there?
He's also very angry.
There you go. Kicking is fine.
Haunted and changed by his sister's murder.
He's hitting on me and he's not minding, and that's just not my son.
And those are normal grief reactions.
Ricky is really acting out. He's showing the world how upset he is. He's showing the world, I want to know who murdered my sister.
On this first visit, Ricky shows he's hurting. Only a few days earlier, Amber's little brother blamed himself for her death.
He says, this is my fault because the bad man took Amber. And I ask him, well, why do you think that? And he says, well, I left Sissy alone. I left her by herself, and it's my fault.
A huge burden for a five-year-old and his mother to bear. Counselors reassure Donna that time will ease the pain.
It's hard to move on. I don't want to. I really don't want to.
But she will, for Ricky and for herself.
This is a journey that we're taking together. We're here to help you.
What to do with Amber's things, however, is part of the journey Donna chooses to take alone. Right after the murder, she packed up her daughter's treasured Barbie dolls and hid them under the bed, as Amber did. 4 months later, she feels the need to put it all away, out of sight.
These were her things, her dolls, her books, her jewelry box. I just couldn't look at it anymore. You really don't make the decision. You just do it.
Amber's clothes still hang in the closet, but her toys are in boxes, and Donna feels tremendous guilt.
It's just like, I don't know, I'm stealing from her.
Her heart is breaking as she and Ricky together remove the precious Pocahontas sheets.
Can you take the sheets off now?
I will. Easy.
Can you fold it up? Can you fold it up? We gotta save it, because we're gonna save it.
Amber's room is now Ricky's. He's in constant motion, but for just a moment he stops to show me a picture of his sister.
Pam, did you get the scissors?
No, I didn't. Where'd you get that? You don't
Somebody
know?
Made it.
With Amber's belongings put away, Donna feels stronger.
Then I think back how much of a fighter she was, and I don't want to let her down. I want her to see that Mama could keep going and be strong and take care of her little brother.
Richard Hagerman. Richard would like to be a policeman.
Every day, every milestone in Ricky's life now seems even more important to Donna. She's determined to show her little boy that life can be normal again. And that he doesn't have to be Amber to hold a special place in her heart.
Good job, Ricky!
Thank you.
Welcome back to me.
Thank you.
Warm arms welcome Donna. After a 2-month leave from job training classes, she's come back to school.
It's one of my first steps of healing, because I know I have to keep going. I got Ricky to take care of. I know I desperately want to finish school.
And it's something Amber wanted for her, too.
And this person here is Donna Whitson.
Donna's nervous, not sure she's ready to concentrate on medical definitions and lab work. But she feels comfortable here with friends she made before Amber's tragedy became a national story. Donna longs for her quiet life out of the public eye. But a trip to Washington, D.C. throws Donna back into the spotlight. It's June. She and Richard are going to testify before a congressional subcommittee. This time, Ricky's going too. It's a trip Donna undertakes with surprising confidence.
I'm a little nervous, but I got my boxing gloves on.
Glenda's proud of her daughter.
She's handled it better than I could, I know, if I was in her shoes.
I'm glad you're able to come up.
Once in Washington, Texas Congressman Martin Frost briefs Amber's parents about what to expect.
And it's a pretty good size, it'll be at a pretty good size hearing room.
Frost is sponsoring a bill to create a nationwide system to track sex offenders. He thinks their heartbreaking experience can influence the vote. They do too.
But when it comes to kids, we need to do everything we can.
The walk to the committee room isn't long, but you can sense their growing tension. They're a long way from home, facing an intimidating but important task.
The Subcommittee on Crime will come to order.
Donna and Richard are among many who testify. As they recount Amber's kidnapping, the room falls silent.
When this man took my daughter, he took my dreams, my best friend.
Take your time, please. I know it's not easy.
Sorry. I would never, ever want another mother to have to go through what I have had gone through, you know, or another child be taken away.
Before my daughter was murdered, I thought this sort of thing only happened to other families. But I'm here today to tell you that all children are at risk.
Their words seem to touch committee members.
There is no way we can bring back your daughter. There's no way the children can be brought back. And that's why this registration is so important.
A decision, the impact of their testimony, won't be known for weeks. On this trip, Donna and Richard share a common goal.
Can you want to go look at that man sitting in that chair up there?
After testifying, they take their son on a tour of the Capitol. They treat each other cordially, but their private lives remain separate. Life is so different now. In the nation's capital, at the Vietnam Memorial, Donna reflects on the loss of other families and her own.
Some people, you know, they come out and tell me, you know, you should be over this, you should be better now. You don't get better, you just deal with it.
And she does, by trying to make some good come from Amber's death. Traffic rushes by on an Arlington freeway, but Donna Whitson's not in a hurry. 6 months after she lost her little girl, Donna's life is slowing down. Her routine is different now, one that includes frequent stops to remember Amber. Donna cares for her child now in the only way she can.
Hey, Amber.
She brings wind chimes and two dolls to Amber's grave.
Still feels like someday she'll walk in the door.
Donna, in fact, often talks about her daughter as if she's alive.
I still want to tell her to go get in the bathtub. It's time to brush your teeth. It's time for dinner. I still have the habit of saying kids, and I still have, you know, people ask me, how many kids you have? Well, I have two. I just can't get used to saying, you know, I only have one child now.
Donna feels depressed and lonely, but stronger, too. And she's frustrated that police still haven't caught Amber's killer.
Have you got any of your paperwork filled out on him yet?
Sergeant Mark Simpson understands. He heads the team of 11 Arlington police investigators whose only job is to find Amber's killer. The Amber Hagerman Task Force has its own office with crime scene maps, notes about a suspect profile, and stacks of leads.
Quite frankly, I thought we'd have him by now.
15 phone tips still come in every week. A reward stands at $75,000, and police insist the investigation is moving forward.
How long we'll go, I don't know. As long as there's a reasonable expectation to solve this case, I'm sure we'll stay with it.
An arrest would help many affected by Amber's death. Stuart Coker, the man who found her body, relives the crime every day. His family makes pink ribbons for each month there's no arrest, which he considers intolerable.
Nobody should be able to get away with this. And to think that somewhere out there, someone knows this individual, and they have not come forward after 6 months, I can't grasp that.
The home of Amber's grandparents, once the center of activity for this tragedy, is now uncomfortably quiet.
And after everybody left, it was kind of hard. You started had time to start thinking about it, and it just really overwhelmed me.
Amber's bike is still here, but no one rides it. And Glenda, who once questioned why God didn't protect her precious granddaughter, again draws strength from him.
I say a prayer for her every night.
What do you ask?
God watch over her. Let her know that we love her. Miss her. Oh,
prayers too help mark the 6-month anniversary of Amber's death. Only a small group attends this vigil, those closest to the 9-year-old with the bright smile. On this warm summer evening, the pain is still heavy. Grief, they've learned, is a slow journey, one without maps or guides, and one that each person faces differently.
Okay, stay by the curb as much as you can.
As summer ends, Ricky starts first grade.
You having fun?
Like the rest of the family, his emotions are erratic.
It's 8 o'clock, another hour, you have to go to night-night.
Donna, too, is exhausted from her own ups and downs.
A lot of times, I just want to go commit suicide. You know, I want to be with her. But I have my son, and I look at his precious little face, and I couldn't do that to him.
Donna, would you come forward?
There have been good moments along the way. In the spring, the Texas Department of Human Services honored Donna for outstanding volunteer work in a welfare office.
We did the first one, number one.
But by fall, welfare officials pressure her to ask Richard for child support and question her access to thousands of dollars donated in Amber's name.
It went to the church, and then I took it from the church and I put it in a trust fund for Ricky for college.
Despite her explanation, Donna and Ricky lose all welfare benefits just 1 month before she's to finish school.
Hi, buddy.
But she manages to go on, some days encouraged by kindness. Other days, she feels shunned.
They don't know what to say to me, so they just don't talk to me at all. They avoid me.
And family members can't avoid feeling guilty that Amber decided to ride her bike too far.
She was just supposed to go around the block, but she didn't go around the block. She went down by that store, so she disobeyed. But no child should, by disobeying just that little bit, should have to pay a price like Amber paid.
For Donna especially, that price means sometimes others blame her, not the elusive killer, for Amber's death.
So hard to deal with.
Well, if you hadn't let your child ride the bike in the first place, she'd still be alive. It's your fault. No, it's not your fault. We can't control the world and what's out there. That's what makes life so scary today.
Scary and lonely. For Donna and Ricky, evenings are often the hardest. Here where they all live together, they feel especially close to Ricky's big sister.
What's Amber doing tonight?
Eating.
What do you think she's eating?
Corn.
Carrots.
Donna tries to reestablish their old routines. With one child now instead of two.
What is that word?
Teaching Ricky to love learning as Amber did.
Rub-a-dub-dub.
And sharing special stories as before.
Every time I walk to school, I walk with my brother.
That's good. That's great.
This shy mother also finds a sense of purpose by reaching out to other children.
We're still sad, but we know Amber's okay. She's in heaven living with Jesus now.
And the family remains determined to make an impact in small and big ways. In October, Amber's parents attend a special ceremony in the White House Rose Garden.
I'd also like to say again a special word of thanks to Richard Hagerman and Donna Whitson.
President Bill Clinton signs the sex offender law they testified about just weeks ago. It's a proud moment for Donna.
We shook hands. He gave me the pen that he signed my daughter's bill with.
And for Richard.
My daughter's death will not be in vain. We're going to, you know, some good is going to come out of this tragic thing that happened.
Today we're unveiling the Amber Plan.
Back home, there's more progress in their daughter's name. A first ever emergency broadcast system alerting listeners to child abductions. The success and the support seem to ease the grief a little.
Happy birthday to you.
Gradually, they're finding things to celebrate.
Walk slow.
Slow.
It's November 25th, A day's sorrow is pushed away by smiles.
Happy birthday to you.
Turn around, Mickey.
Amber's 10th birthday. Her family celebrates as if she were here, with a few exceptions. Now, this is part of Amber's birthday, too.
Happy birthday to you. We love you, baby.
Amazing grace.
In private, Donna's grief remains quiet and deep.
That saved a wretch.
Sometimes she talks to Amber.
Ask her what she's doing. Is she liking where she's at now? Is she happy?
Blessed assurance.
And she finds comfort in other ways.
Praising my Savior.
Take your blood pressure today.
Donna has finished an internship and school. She's now looking for work as a medical assistant, hoping to help others. And she remains hopeful someone will find Amber's killer. Donna continues to meet with Task Force Supervisor Mark Simpson. All these months later, the leads are shrinking, and so is the staff of detectives. Amber's death changed many lives, among them Mark Simpson, who gave up another job in the department to take over her murder case. Amber's grandfather, Jimmy Whitson, returned to work almost immediately. The same job, the same friends, but it feels different.
You know, we can't go back, so we just got to go forward and, you know, do the best we can.
He tells me the family's closer now. Their time together and memories are even more precious, like their little girl in the big front yard tree.
That tree's always Amber's tree. She'd climb way up there and she'd sit there. No, I'm not coming down.
Glenda Whitson can smile again, feeling more at peace since dreaming her granddaughter return to give her a hug.
I just made the thought, well, Amber was coming back to tell Grandma it's all gonna be okay.
Yeah.
Richard Hagerman and a few volunteers now operate their advocacy group, PASO, from their homes. As donations dwindled, Richard returned to his job.
I didn't want to go back to work because I was afraid I'd be letting go of Amber, I guess. It would cause me to forget, but I found out it didn't.
Come here.
Stuart Coker wishes he could forget. Recently, he moved his family across town to escape the memory of finding Amber's body.
Just the why me. You know, I ask God all the time, why me? And for that, there's no answer.
As for Amber's friends, they're in fourth grade this year and feeling better.
I'm happy for all the little girls that were her friends because they seem to be a little bit happier this year, but there's just something missing.
We are here tonight in loving memory of Amber Hagerman.
At this birthday vigil, there's still sadness.
It'll be okay. You know, she's in heaven. She's having a birthday party with the angels today.
And words of consolation.
You don't be sad, okay? Amber wouldn't want you to be sad, okay?
Happy birthday, dear Amber.
Mostly, Amber's 10th birthday party is happy.
Okay, let's make a wish and let's blow it out. Wanna blow it out, Amber?
One?
Somehow they feel good again. Serving Amber's favorites, chocolate cake and vanilla ice cream.
We really didn't ever want to eat vanilla ice cream again because that was Amber's favorite.
For months they have mourned her. Now with small steps and time, they are healing and discovering ways to celebrate her life.
Make a wish and blow out, baby.
Amber Hagerman lived just 9 years, but then and now, she continues to touch so many of us.
She seemed to be precious and special and wonderful. You could see it in her eyes. She's got a hold of my heart. I will not forget.
Some may question why the family chose to share these most private moments with all of us. Their reasons are their own. But for those first 5 terrible days, their daughter became everyone's little girl. They ask us all to hold our children a little tighter, to treasure them a little more, so the tragedy that touched them never happens again.
Though we can't see each other, we can't touch each other, but You know, I just want to let her know that I'm still here for her. You know, I won't forget her ever, ever.
If you have any information to help catch and convict the killer of Amber Hagerman, call the Arlington Police Department, 817-469-TIPS.
Keep smiling, keep shining, knowing you can always count on me, for sure.